President Trump sending 2,000 to 4,000 National Guard troops to the southern border, warning a horde of illegal immigrants is on the way and planning to cross into the United States. Critics, however, say the situation simply isn't that dire. The group that the president was referring to has splintered and shrunk since it started out. And remember, this is actually an annual event, and it's expected to get even smaller. CNN's Leila Santiago is with part of the caravan that has stopped for a few days in Puebla, Mexico, and joins us now live. Leila, where do we stand at this point?
Listen, there are actually still people from that caravan coming this morning. I've seen about 20 people, and most of them are families. It's interesting because I talked to one woman and I said, hey, President Trump says that this caravan is dangerous. And she said, I am armed with my children. And she showed me three little kids that she came to Puebla with, waiting for the rest of the caravan to arrive. So where are we right now? Well, yesterday, one bus arrived, about 70 people. They were in Oaxaca before, several hours south of where we are, and they are making their way up to Puebla. But as you mentioned, this is a group that's getting smaller. Typically, that happens every year. They've been doing this for more than 5 years, and typically they do get smaller. The organizers are telling us that they are delaying things a bit. They are taking their time on this because of this extra attention. Surely they are overwhelmed, and they want to make sure that as these Central Americans who have come up with this caravan make their way up, that they are protected. So when they will arrive to the U.S., we still don't know. Many have decided they will stay here in Mexico, but organizers are telling us that they believe about 200 will make it up to the U.S.-Mexico border to seek asylum. Why seek asylum? I was speaking to that exact same woman, and she sort of echoed what many here have said. They've said, yes, the conditions in Central America, so El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, they're not great. Yes, they are dealing with poverty, but even more so, they're talking about the violence that they are facing. The woman I spoke to said that her family members have been killed because gang violence is such a problem in the neighborhood that she is in, or she was in, rather, from El Salvador. So this is a caravan that continues, albeit in smaller numbers, and takes issue with being labeled as dangerous or not qualifying for someone who needs to seek asylum, given the violence that they say they are fleeing.
Well, and to that point, Leila, part of what we heard from the president yesterday was that, and these are his words, that female migrants were being raped at levels nobody has ever seen before. Is that what you're hearing from
people? I have now spoken to three women and directly asked them, have you been raped? Are you seeing this? So they're using the words that President Trump said. And all three of them have said to me, we have had no issues with that. Now, let's keep this in context, because I've covered quite a bit of immigrants in Mexico as well as on the U.S. side of the border. And that is always the concern. This is a very dangerous journey. People are raped along the way, but that is why the caravan is so important to them, because they are finding safety in numbers. If they go together, they can protect themselves against some of these threats that are very common along the journey.
Leila Santiago with the latest for us from Puebla, Mexico. Leila, thank you. Joining us now, John Sandwake, former acting director of U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement and former acting general counsel for Homeland Security. As we look at all of this and we hear what the president is warning about, we hear from Leila in terms of the caravan and all the folks she's met there and the reality on the ground. You've said the issues that the president lays out are not things that are going to be solved with National Guard troops on the border, that this is largely symbolic. So what is the larger issue?
Well, as Leila indicated, what we're seeing now, it's dramatically different than what we saw 4 years ago. We're seeing large numbers of Central Americans who are fleeing gang violence and horrific conditions in their home countries. They're not coming into this country and crossing our border and trying to evade capture. That's historically what we've seen along the border. What this population is actually doing is trying to surrender to the U.S. authorities and seek protection and political asylum. So, you know, it's funny, the president wants to order the National Guard, and where the National Guard can provide some utility is in detecting illegal intrusions into the United States. But we've never had a Border Patrol that's better staffed, better equipped, and facing, frankly, less activity at the border than we are right now. So the problem really is in the officers and officials and immigration judges who sort out these asylum claims and kind of weed out the legitimate claims from the false claims. And the National Guard, unless we're going to make them immigration judges, they're not going to help us with that problem.
So that's where you're saying we need a little bit more attention. Are there any risks to sending these troops to the border?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look, the use of force protocols for guardsmen and military officials are dramatically different than civilian officials. And I think in some ways it's almost demeaning to the Border Patrol to suggest that we could just take a National Guardsman who's trained for other activities and just put him in a Border Patrol's position. Border Patrol agents go through an extensive training. There's a specialized law enforcement academy for the Border Patrol, and it's months before they're ever able to patrol and do their job alone on the border. So you could see a situation where somebody gets hurt, and you could also see a situation where international tensions with Mexico, something goes wrong and things get kind of heated as it relates to our foreign relations.
You bring up the word heated. I mean, this is a heated conversation, not just internationally, but domestically as well. People have very clear ideas on what they feel needs to be done. What are we missing from the conversation?
Well, I got to tell you, that's the problem. You know, I've worked on immigration enforcement issues for a long time, and there's no other issue where politics drive bad policies than in immigration enforcement. From across the board, from interior enforcement and ICE and sanctuary cities to what's going on at the border. Unfortunately, I think the debate is far too often not informed by fact. And as a result, because of the heated politics, we end up with bad policies. There's no other law enforcement agency other than DHS that's as, you know, subjected to the pushing and pulling of politics than is, ICE and CBP.
John Sandway, really appreciate your time today. Thank you.